Welcome to this eighth podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to the different kinds of addiction. We will talk about the different types of addiction and the common neurobiology across addictions, the addiction model and common behavioral patterns, and multiple addictions and the consequences of associated interactions. There are two main categories or types of addiction. The first category is known as the substance-related addictions, and these include the abuse of alcohol, tobacco, and street or prescription drugs. A second category is the behavioral or process addictions, and these include gambling, food, work, shopping, sex, and the internet. The important thing to know here is that all of these addictions produce similar chemical reactions in the brain and behavioral actions by the individual. In fact, process addictions often exist in combination with each other and with other chemical addictions. Despite their prevalence, however, process addictions in particular are under-recognized and under-treated. There are millions of chemical compounds in the world, but only about 20 of them fall into the category of drugs of abuse. These drugs differ in structure and function, but their core neurochemistry is the same. All produce elevations of the neurotransmitter dopamine in the reward system of the brain. Basic and neuroimaging research shows that all drugs of abuse increase the release of dopamine in one key structure of the reward system, the nucleus accumbens. Over time, the large quantities of dopamine produce neuroadaptations within the reward circuitry that result in a dampening of dopamine activity in this area. This means that in the absence of dopamine-releasing drugs, the reward system of drug abusers is chronically understimulated. This helps drive many of the drug-seeking behaviors that are characteristic of addiction. Release of dopamine in the nucleus accumbens, in anticipation of reward, also underlies the rewarding properties of natural reinforcers like food and sex. In other words, natural reinforcers like food exhibit the same core neurobiology as drugs of abuse. Dr. James Montgomery is the medical director at the Pine Grove Behavioral Health Center. Here he describes the similarities between process and chemical addictions.
Many of the things we're talking about, food, reproduction, anxiety, are part of the life-saving survival systems that we have. But as humans, we like to be sensual. We like to have our senses involved in everything we do. We've talked about how smell is a powerful thing in addiction. And one of the things that I think is useful to look at is that the greater these two interact, the more likely we are to become addicted to a behavior, and the more likely they are to interact. So we've talked about this. I can run through the slides of the areas of the brain where all chemical addictions and the addictive processes where we can follow the chemical. We're basically talking about dopamine. If we look again at the spec scan of somebody involved in looking at their gambling object, perhaps it is slot machines, perhaps it's a deck of cards, we see that the ventral tegmentum and the cingulate gyrus are activated. The same things that we would see in the cocaine addict who is actively reminiscing their addiction. We've all talked about how dopamine is involved, and what I would summarize these up when I do this with our patients is just notice that the red line goes up for all of them. The numbers are different, but they're there. We can do the same thing with food and the same thing with sex. Dopamine is acutely involved.
Dr. Mark Gold is the Donald Disney Eminent Scholar, distinguished professor, and chair of psychiatry at the University of Florida. Here he discusses how drug abusers have low brain dopamine activity, and this indicates an understimulated reward system.
The common theme of addiction is what's addiction, and addiction has certain attributes. So you have binging, you have withdrawal, you have cross-sensitization, you have increased drive for the drug and locomotion, increased consumption, and we all model that in rats or mice. And that's the way the world has gone. In humans, the imaging studies have helped us a great deal. So while dopamine's released in response to hitting a lever, getting cocaine, hitting a lever, getting cocaine, hitting a lever, getting placebo after you expect cocaine, well, dopamine's released all that time. The question, and the same for cannabis, the same for all drugs of abuse. The question is, what's the significance of that in humans? And you can kind of see pretty clearly here that there's a D2 receptor downregulation with chronic use of cocaine, so that you can't see any of the kind of dopamine compared to controls. Cocaine kind of wipes it out. 1984 was the beginning of the dopamine hypothesis. In 1985, we had a review with human data supporting dopamine deficiency in chronic use among human addicts. And methamphetamine would be pretty much the same as cocaine. Again, major depletion, and heroin, and so forth. So when you look at, this is Jean-Jack Wang's work and Nora's work at Brookhaven, if you look at obesity, what you find is the same thing.
Dr. Ray Baker is a physician and the medical director of HealthQuest Occupational Health Corporation, an organization in Vancouver specializing in addiction medicine. Dr. Baker has not only treated thousands of people with addiction, he also overcame his own addiction with drugs and alcohol. Here he describes the power addiction has on the reward system of the brain.
Once I've developed addiction, and some would say, for some people, it's even before they developed addiction, but for sure, once I've developed addiction, I lose the ability, or I've lost the ability, to comfort myself. So I am not very good at making use of the tools that other people use to deal with their emotional discomfort or stress or whatever the dysphoria that they're feeling. So I am more likely to turn to the mood-altering substance or activity that comforts me.
Right.
So, and the trouble is, as I continue to use the substance, alcohol, other drugs, cocaine, Demerol, whatever, two things happen. One is neuroadaptation happens, so that my brain adapts and it takes more. My ability to experience euthymia or feeling okay goes down and down and down. So just stopping the drug, and by the way, as I continued using the drug, they became less and less and less effective. So I got less and less comfort, but now it's like I'm on a treadmill. I can't stop.
Thus far, we have examined the neurochemistry of process and chemical addictions. But is there a similarity in the behavior patterns exhibited by addicted individuals across both types of addiction? It turns out there is. Dr. Montgomery discusses this while talking about the addiction model.
When we talk about chemical addiction, I look to Helen Fisher's early writings about relationships, because we know that all chemical addictions affect that reward system. They help us to feel good. But when Fisher talks about romantic love, people who are wildly and madly in love, they have elevated levels of dopamine, which produce exhilaration, increased energy, hyperactivity, sleeplessness, loss of appetite, trembling and a pounding heart, anxiety and fear. At the same time, the elevated levels of norepinephrine generally produce exhilaration, excessive energy, sleeplessness, and the loss of appetite. That driven drumbeat of addiction is driven with no chemical, only that loved one. She also goes on to say that when we interact at that level, many times the one in love will change the way they talk, the way they dress, the way they act. One of my favorite quotes is that they continue to pursue even when the dice of life consistently come up against them. because part of the process is that adversity heightens that. Being dumped is more powerful in terms of dopamine. Having the addiction taken away drives that center to crave more. When we talk about addiction and sex addiction and compulsivity, we always reflect on the pathological gambling model. As Mark said last night, it is a real addiction by the DSM. So we can use these criteria. Again, familiar words, the recurrent failure to resist, continuing to engage in the behaviors over a longer period of time than planned, failed efforts to reduce, stop, or control the behavior, inordinate amounts of time in obtaining, acting on, or recovering from the behaviors, and that preoccupation with the process. Frequently engaging the behavior when they should be doing something else that they say is important. The recurrent significant problems show up in life, and the addict continues in the process when it would make sense to do something differently. The need for increased intensity, frequency, and risk level, we're talking about tolerance. Giving up or limiting social, fun things just to be engaged in the behavior. Distress, anxiety, or restlessness, or irritability if they can't have it. Detox, withdrawal symptoms.
It's rare that an addiction exists as a unique behavior in an individual. In fact, process addictions often occur in combination with other process and chemical addictions. And when they do, this is known as multiple addiction. When multiple addictions are present, there is a possibility that they may interact with one another. Dr. Montgomery discusses the strong, often inseparable link between multiple addictions.
The addiction interaction disorder, where we have this cycle of arousal and pleasure that leads to numbing and then deprivation, and then that dissociation and fantasy that allows for ramping up. Because so many times the goal in sexual compulsion, much like the goal in eating disorders and gambling, is not the prize. It's not the orgasm. It's the process. It is going through that fantasy and that escape that comes with it. Whether we're dealing with substances, across the board, or processes such as appetites, where we're talking about both food and sex and love, but also work and money and our relationship with money and exercise and the pleasure that it gives. Relationships. I like McAuliffe and McAuliffe's definition of addiction as a primary committed pathological love relationship between a person and a mood-altering experience. It is that relationship, because if they just pull the mood-altering experience, the chemical, the behavior out, the relationship continues to drive itself, and it creates that black hole that is in the center of addiction interaction. Then we start dealing with the core affective states. How does it feel? The most difficult part of longer-term recovery is learning how to feel. How do I learn excitement? One of the things that I tell gambling addicts, you got to stop running yellow lights. It's a win-lose situation, because in Dallas, if you don't run the yellow light, you might get rear-ended. But that notion of, can I make it, can I not, ramps up that addictive process. The shame and the guilt when looking at those behaviors and saying, look at what I did, and now what I deal with it. And it, Carnes has talked about, and don't call it love, it takes about a year to learn what not to do, a year to find out what tools are in the bag, and a year to figure out what to do with them. And by about that time in life, the decisions about bankruptcy, about selling the house, about ending the relationship, have all come to fruition, and they're sitting right there in the affective lap. Now what do I do? The shame, the misery, and the rage that comes with it, because how do we respond to what we don't like? We go back to that infant. How many of you had babies that thanked you for changing their diaper when they were young? They scream bloody murder as though we're killing them when it is in their best interest. We don't like change, and we respond to it with rage.
When addictions do interact with one another, this produces certain patterns of behavior. What this means is that coexisting conditions combine in ways that produce unique outcomes. Dr. Montgomery elaborates.
The patterns of behavior in an addiction interaction process, we can have cross-tolerance, where simultaneous increases in two or more addictions raise the tolerance for both so that I need both of them and I need to pair them together. Perhaps it's withdrawal mediation, where one addiction is used to soften the effects of withdrawal. We see this frequently in the stimulant addict who takes a couple of Xanax bars or some diazepam or smokes a joint to come down from the irritable effects of the stimulant. Many times in the process addictions, that's where chemicals such as alcohol and cannabis come into play. Replacement of one addiction. I have to stop this. We talked about how people switch addictions early in recovery. It supplants the other addiction. And out of nowhere comes a desire that's never been there before. And there can also be alternating addiction cycles. I have a case that I present frequently to patients in explaining this, where after getting fired, a young man goes to the bar, he drinks, it's not good enough, he goes racing through a small town, town square, as fast as he can with his loud muffler going, can't attract a cop, goes home, smokes a joint to slow down, that's not good enough, goes back out and gets some crack to smoke, that gets scary, so he goes home and locks himself in the house and drinks some more, and before he knows what happened, he is being arrested for being a peeping Tom and looking into his neighbor's window. The two alternating to try to facilitate the process. One addiction masking the other, where many people have controlled that chemical by being involved in another one. We talked about the switch from chemicals to food yesterday. The ability to have a negative urine drug screen and still be outright goofy. It's part of the addictive process. And when we talk about monitoring for the physician's health programs, the urine drug screens are great. But part of the problem is, by the time the drug screen is positive, the behavior has been going on for weeks. And looking at trying to find out what that masking process. Sometimes the ritual is enough. Seeing that I almost won on that slot machine is enough to make me feel better. So part of what I'll do is I'll engage in a behavior to help me to both stand back, but also lead me into the next addiction. Intensification. Sex addicts who violate risks under the influence, using that couple of shots to go out and pursue the one-night stand, they begin to help each other out, and then numbing, trying to get the pain to go away by putting something else in the slot, in the black hole, that makes me think I'm feeling better. Disinhibiting, where one addiction lowers the boundary of another, combining the addictions, inhibiting, using the one addiction to handle the other. The cocaine addict who logs onto the internet to masturbate for hours just to keep the edge off, and then it quits working. And then finally, using one addiction with another to achieve the effects that are possible only with both.
So here's a summary of the key points in this podcast. All drugs of abuse increase the release of dopamine in a key structure of the reward system, the nucleus accumbens. In the absence of dopamine-releasing drugs, the reward system of drug abusers is chronically understimulated, and this helps drive many of the drug-seeking behaviors that are characteristic of addiction. This neurochemistry is identical for both process and substance addictions. Process addictions often occur in combination with other process and chemical addictions, and when they do, this is known as multiple addiction. When multiple addictions are present, there is a possibility that they may interact with each other. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMeds competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. First, in your role as a medical student or practicing physician, you'll often be the first point of contact for people suffering from addiction. What steps will you take to ensure you approach, engage, and relate to a patient with an addiction with professionalism and respect? 2. How could you integrate this new knowledge on process addictions when obtaining the personal history of your patient? 3. Reflect on a line of questioning that would allow you to explore the possibility that a patient presents with multiple addictions. We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on different types of addiction. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.